Hey, what's up, people? Welcome to episode 1 of Fortified 45, the soundtrack to inspired lives. I'm DJ Mista Pierre. Now, before I introduce the first guest on our show, allow me to explain the concept. So each guest shares a selection of music that they love or hate, or more importantly, have either described, inspired, or been influential at key stages of their life. This, of course, is interdispersed with good old banter, wholesome discourse, and an insight into their inspired lives. Now, before I forget, please like and subscribe and rung or tell a friend. I'll thank you all. Now, in this episode, I'm in conversation with the prolific, multi-talented Musa Okwonga. Musa has a multifaceted career and is a self-confessed workaholic. After graduating from Oxford, he had a brief stint in the city as a lawyer, then controversially gave that up to pursue his true passions. Fast forward to the present time, Musa is now part owner of the successful podcast Studio. He is a writer for Ringer and has published articles in the New York Times and The Guardian, respectively. Musa is also an author. His most recent book at the time of this recording is called In the End, It Was All About Love. This was closely preceded by a book called One of Them, an Eton memoir, and also a collaboration with Ian Wright, a book called Striking Out. Now, this episode unfortunately contains a few expletives in it, so if you are easily offended, please like and subscribe. Finally, links to books or any related media can be found in the keynotes or the description of the podcast. So that's all the admin done. Let's get into conversation with myself and Musa Okwonga on Fortified 45s. 45, 45, 45, 45, 45. Moose, how are you, man?
Very well, thanks. How are you?
I'm good. Welcome to 45 45s, my maiden voyage.
I'm loving it here in Dawson. Good to be back.
We're good.
Stomping ground.
Yeah, man. Big up to pirate.com. They do a great facility here, so I have to shout them out.
I like it a lot. So you're moving up in the world when it came to this.
I'll get sideways, man.
Come a long way.
Angulating. Listen, I can pretend that I haven't seen you for a long time, but I saw you on Monday after years of you, after your disappearance, but I like to call it that.
Yeah, it was.
Being kind. We had a good time on Monday.
Yeah, it was a vibe. So yeah, for those who don't know, I launched a book, In the End It Was All About Love, with Rough Trade. Shout out to them, Rough Trade Books, in January 2021. Because the pandemic, didn't have the launch until the
right,
other night.
Right.
It was amazing, yeah.
It was amazing, and you know, I was blessed to be able to DJ there. Thank you for, you know, giving me the gig there. We had a great time. I mean, it was so organic. We had some great readings. Remind me, sorry, I'm terrible.
Yeah, it's good. It's good. We had Inuit Elms starting out, the great playwright, Nikesh Shukla, amazing novelist, brilliant novelist. Then the four brown girls
yep.
who write. One of them is missing. Roshni was missing, but Sharon, Sunna, and Sheena were all there, which was amazing. And then we had Mr. Ian Wright. I was in conversation with him.
Amazing.
And then yourself on the decks. And it was funny because when I got to curate the night, you were like, I was like, first choice. You were the first person I thought of.
Thanks, man.
Because I just knew that you would like, because you played in between each of the acts and also at the end. And I just knew that you'd be able to like kind of curate the night and get the musical vibes going.
Oh, thank you, man. I had great fun doing that. It's like a new challenge for some DJs, just can turn up and that's their gig. But sometimes I like to just curate and have fun with it and just, you know.
Yeah, but the good thing was you kept the energy throughout. Like, so it was that the tempo was constantly, it's like watching one of those like 90 minute games of football where the tempo is constantly up. Like there's a midfielder who's just constantly keeping the ball in possession. He did that. You kind of kept the tempo in play, which is really good. Yeah.
It's good thing you said midfield. We need to have a conversation.
Okay. Let's get to it.
So how I met you.
Yep. Yeah.
For the first time, I was playing for Stonewall Football Club. Big up to Stonewall FC.
Yep. Yeah.
And I was kind of not lost, but I was in transition. Coming out the hood, came from DJing in America, and I was coming out as a professional gay man. Not that I'm a professional gay, but I'm just a professional man and being more comfortable with
my. And how do you navigate that? Yeah.
Yeah. Stonewall Football Club is a very good ground or fulcrum for you to do that. You can meet people, play football with them, not necessarily have any biblical relationships with them or anything like that. It's a good place for you to go there and meet people from all around the world. So big up to Stonewall for that. But what I found at that time was that I was a minority within a minority. So, yes, I was a black guy, a black gay guy, but I wasn't doing high kicks and pointed toes. Nothing wrong with doing that. But I like hip hop and the way I dressed, the music I liked, the way I carried myself. I think I found some members there had difficulty with that.
Okay.
And they thought I was a gay man trapped in a straight man's body because I listened to hip hop and all the hyper masculinity associated with listening to that music.
They thought that wasn't really you.
Exactly. Or that wasn't how a gay person should be, more importantly.
Yes, yes, yes.
So, I left and came back, because I had still had affinity for there. You know, and I'm there just tearing up the midfield, running it very, very quick. And then you turned up. Taller than me, annoying, just marginally.
But that's true, marginally.
Marginally, I was quicker than you, Musa.
Well, do you know what? You can have that. We all have our own narratives.
That is so...
We all have our own narratives. And if that's your narrative, if that's what you want, then you take that.
Fine,
you take that.
Fine. Let's just move on from this one. But no, you had more dribbling skills. You had a better footballing brain than I have. And lots of other people as well. You came there and you rocked it. But you came with... Apart from
well,
your
that's
own
very,
story,
Phil, for those listening, I mean, that's very kind of him. But like, you have plenty of game, man. Don't worry about that. Like, but yeah, but still, you're saying.
Yeah, but you came, your energy and what you brought as a person of colour to Stonewall, which was bereft of people of colour at that time. You brought your own unique story. You told me that the Eton, which just blew my mind. I'm still processing it now. I've read, you know, one of them, but you told me the story. But what you brought was another dimension to a black person at Stonewall that had another story. And you're warm, but you also brought another uniqueness, which helped me feel better in my place there.
That's so funny because I'd never heard this before. Like, as I never thought that. When I turned up at Stonewall, I looked at people like you and Ashley.
OBE.
Yeah, exactly. You're people who, like, much respect him. Like, I saw you as, like, completely... I didn't assume you had any challenges like that. I assumed you were like comfortable in yourselves and I got a lot of strength in that. Like, I turned up at Stonewall basically like, it's tough for me being out, being openly, you know, queer. It's hard for me as a black person. No question, it's hard anyway. And it's hard as a black person because we were invisible.
Yeah.
But one thing I always knew was, I was like, whatever happens, I can play football. Let me go to Stonewall and work on the rest of my identity.
Yeah.
From a cornerstone that I know. Like, I know I can play. And it was funny, turning up there, I was just like, we're going to do this.
Yeah.
We're going to have these. And we just went on a run. The first seven games, we won our first seven games.
Yeah, we did. Yeah. But it's amazing meeting you on a football pitch because we actually like football. You know, we were actually passionate about it. We enjoyed the game. We actually played it. But some people, you know, were there for different reasons, but we really loved football.
Absolutely, yeah.
And we'll talk about that passion. But what I really liked about you as well, you were into hip-hop. I mean, but not just into hip-hop, like I'm into hip-hop. You understood it. You felt the flow. And at that time, there's very few gay people or queer people who knew about hip hop that I could talk with on that same. So that was so refreshing for me. It actually made me feel more comfortable about myself that I wasn't just some unique freak.
You know, that's funny just that, because I remember like they were navigating, you know, the gay scene, the queer scene at the time. And now we've got Lil Nas X and he's like chart topping in America. It's amazing. Yep. It's a new universe, right? But back at that point, a lot of gay people, queer people, were still navigating their relationship with hip-hop, which is very difficult.
Yeah.
And like, to be a gay rapper was like, that was the only thing you could be. Like, if you were a gay rapper, that was the thing. Like, I'm a gay rapper, and that's like, it would dominate your content, whereas Lil Nas X is just a rapper who happens to be gay that makes absolute bangers, and then like, people will have things to say about him, and there'll be a lot of support for him. There's a lot of support. So he is, you know, that whole game, the things that are completely commonplace now, when we came through, they were still being navigated.
So how did you manage to navigate? For me, I was cocky and not arrogant, but I wanted to make a stance in my own way. But did you have any difficulty playing in a gay team in a straight league, which we were doing? So what we were doing was being pioneering. We were handshaking via sport.
Yes.
Was that a primary fear for you?
You know, it was the first team we played, a team called A3 Milan. I'll never forget the two black centre midfielders, and they hated us.
Oh, yes.
You could feel it. They hated us. And I remember this because we turned up at the bandstand. I was one of the first people there, I think. I was like, you know, really early. And our manager, Lazza, was like, we're going to play here. Like, what position do you play? And everyone was a striker, right? No one wants to play. And I was like, I'll be in midfielder. Never played centre mid in my life.
Seriously?
I'd never played centre mid in my life. Ever. Until
you
I was
boxed
just,
the box in
I was a number. Place. I was a number nine my entire life. I'd never played centre mid until that day at Stonewall.
Wow.
And I just thought to myself, I literally thought to myself, okay, you got to play centre mid. Don't tell anyone that because you're here to like contribute. You're here to be a team member.
Yeah.
And I was like, okay, what would Patrick Vieira do? took the number 4 shirt and thought, what would Vieira do? Where would he stand positionally? And I thought to myself, if you're a defensive midfielder, you don't stand in the centre circle when the ball gets punted from them.
Yep.
You stand 10 yards back. So when the flick-ons come, you'll get every flick-on. And I remember I was learning centre mid in real time in that game.
That footballing brain is what I sense from you.
Just like constantly planning, thinking, analysing structures, infrastructure, like how do you counter, how do you this? And I scored the equaliser where they were 2 and up, and I scored the equaliser. Yeah. Ripped it in the bottom corner from 20 yards. And then like we won 3-2, Martin scored the winner. And the way that those black centre midfielders, because they looked at us, it was the homophobia, because it was like, what are people like you doing in the team like this? We can handle the white ones, but not this.
Yes.
The entire game, all these tackles were coming. They'd foul you late, and they'd jog away. They'd never look at you. And then when the game finished, wouldn't even shake our hands.
Yes. And I would make a point of going over shaking everybody's hand.
Yeah.
And some would say, you know, respect.
They wanted no part of it. They were like, this is Babylon, and they were gone.
But do you think they're... Because football has a very...
Yeah.
Has a place in masculinity.
Yes, yes.
Do you think that we demasculated them?
Yeah, we shattered it. Do you remember the team? We beat a team... do you remember this team we beat called Milbank? Milbank, we beat them 3-2. They hadn't lost on their pitch in 3 years. They had not conceded 3 goals in 3 years.
Yeah.
We destroyed them 3-1. And they were saying all kinds of things. They had a guy with a pink tat top beneath, and we killed them 3-2 on their own pitch. They're up in Willesden.
Yes.
And we defeated them. Yeah, that likes of East European Sports Stadium type vibes. Yeah, yeah. We went past the dressing room at the end, and they were screaming at each other. Yeah. They were screaming at each other. But the next time we played them, they actually beat us quite badly the next time in Hackney Marshes. But one of them fouled you after about 20 minutes, and they sprinted to help you up. The guy that had been a dick in the previous match, and the second time he played them, when he fouled you, he ran over and was like, are you okay? And he was like so concerned. And I was like, that changed. And they beat us quite bad in the next game. But the respect after that game was like, they're just footballers.
So for me...
We changed them. We changed that.
We did. But I think it also changed our perception of sometimes we could be expecting straight or non-queer people to...
Yeah, it changed us.
I think it changed our perception of people and sometimes the patience and the... what's the word? Compassion that we need to.
We saw a lot more acceptance than we expected.
Yep.
Actually, I found a lot more than I expected. Yep. Like to the point where people were like, "They're just a football team, and they're a good team, and they're good lads, or whatever." And it was really powerful. And you saw sometimes the change from the first time we played the team to the second time we played them. Yep. The speed that we changed perceptions, I think, was very, very fast. Actually,
and that did a lot more about. For my confidence going into the professional corporate
it's
world.
Hugely. Yeah, because you're being seen as a man that sleeps with men. You're being seen as a gay man. That's extremely powerful. You're out there.
Yeah.
You're doing your thing and people are looking at you going like, they can make that judgment. But you're holding it. You're handling it. You're holding yourself. And I knew that. I thought, if I do this, I've got to live this with who am I before I came out?
Yeah.
I've got to be the same person. My friend said, the nicest compliment, he said, Musa, when you came out, you did not change one bit. No. You didn't change one bit, your personality, anything. And when I played football, I was like, I bring the levels.
You did.
Listen, we all did, man. We brought serious levels.
We did. Look, so that's how we met, but let's get into the music for a bit.
Yeah, sure.
Our first track, what is it and why? Let's listen to it first.
We're doing this for money.
Life and die, ripped from the belly of the beast, where we pour out henny for deceased. Numbers don't climb, give a penny for the guy, but they won't give a penny to the streets. Belly gonna repeat their Linux and machines, when they should have been reveling their teens. But privileged kids got a semi in their jeans, these kids got a semi in their jeans. Mad to believe this is what our street to come to. Warfare with nowhere to run to. But all is fair, these cunts don't love you, that's why I stay with a quick 16 on me. Nobody can take these 16s from me. Make my paper and tuck that properly. Pay my tax and fuck those bobbies. Trust nobody. I ain't meeting no soups in lobbies. I ain't smoking no zoops with Donnie. I ain't handing that man no brollies. When I rain on all of these wallies. Bare bodies. You can have a bear's body. Don't dare cross me. Life of a lyricist. In the times that we're living in, gotta speak mind of the bigger thing. Shine is irrelevant. The grind is imperative. Gotta put pride up a million. Scribe what the vision is. Never lie to the listeners. Don't hype on the innocent. I'm with the pie is a million. Slice it and divvy it. That's my us. Life and lyrics.
Every day.
Pile up figures.
Every day.
Work so hard.
Every day.
We're dying for a living.
Every day.
For the clothes and the cars.
Every day.
Welcome to my city.
Every weekend, yeah.
That's Kano, Good Youtes Amongst Evil. Talk to me about that one.
So this song, so I live in Berlin. I've been there for 7 years now. And it's been an experience that's changed my life. It's been incredible. And many, many great things about Berlin, but also many challenges. And one of the big challenges is racism. And listening to Kano and that song, sort of Good Youtes Walk Among Evil, the whole theme of the song is like, you can go through really tough things as a black person specifically. Huh. And still emerge happy, victorious, successful. So I would listen to that as my kind of like my theme music.
Yeah.
You know, especially in winter, like I've always said to my friends, like Kano sounds better. Like every 10 degrees colder you get, Kano sounds even better.
I like that because as a DJ, sometimes the music you choose is based on the weather.
Yes. That's so interesting.
You can play some songs and they just don't work. And I was like, this song's brilliant. Usually they like it. And I had to learn that some songs just don't work. If it's cold or summer, it just doesn't work.
Well, depending on what it's like outside or... It's funny. When I went to a bar once in Holland, it was Maastricht, a friend's wedding, and I went to this bar. It's a similar thing in relation to music.
Yeah.
And there was a guy, there was an expert taster in ales, and I went into like the bar, and I'm going to order a drink. And I said, I would like this to drink. And he said, no, hang on a minute. He said, what's the last thing you drank?
Wow.
And I was like, oh. I said, oh, it's this. And he goes, okay. And what flavour did you want? I said, this. And he said, okay, you don't want that. You want this. And he gave me a drink that was the perfect sequel to my previous drink that was also the thing that I wanted. Amazing. And music's like that.
Wow.
Music is like, what do you want to listen to? Okay, what's the last thing you felt? Okay, have that. And that's what I feel with that song. It's almost like that music kind of, it spoke to a time when the far right in Berlin was really rising, getting quite scary, quite dangerous, organized as well. And that song came along at a time when I was just like, it makes me feel empowered and brave. And I walk the street going,
brilliant.
I could walk among this evil and win.
So, I'd like to use, that's a good segue actually, because you and I used to be neighbours, right? Good old East London neighbours.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, we used to come and hang out, and we used to have chats, and we never see each other quite often, but when we did, we would download and just have these really good, poignant, relevant, deep talk conversations. We'd catch up. You disappeared. I was like, where is he? And then then you sprouted out up in Germany. Brilliant. I love it. What made you go to Berlin? Was it a pre-Brexit premonition? Why did you know?
Kind of, you know, it's weird. I didn't know Brexit was coming, but I felt something was coming because I was working abroad at the time, you know, covering a lot of games, different bits of football, and I was traveling with work. So the year before I left the UK, I was doing a lot of traveling. And when you land back in your country after traveling, you normally feel a kind of lift. Oh, I'm back, like home. That had gone.
Wow.
I was like, this is weird. And so then I was like, let me interrogate that a bit further. So I went away, then I was away for a month, like covering the World Cup in Brazil, 2014.
Nice.
Yeah, it was amazing. I was covering the World Cup, and during that time, I was reading the press back in the UK, and I was like, immigration. I was just like, they really hate us. Like, this is going nowhere good. This is a real problem. So I said to my mum, I was like, I just can't live my entire life in a country that hates us this much. I can't do it. I can't give my whole life to a country. I've got to go and try something else for a bit.
So do you feel that you're still an immigrant even though you were born here?
Do you know what? I never would have said that until a few years ago, but I started the last 15 years, 10 years made me feel like an immigrant.
Yeah.
And that was a thing. This is a new thing. I think it began like 2005 when Michael Howard ran for Conservative Party leader and Prime Minister. Yeah. And he had this like one of the most racist campaigns I've ever seen. Are you thinking what we're thinking about immigration? I was like, hang on a minute. And I go into work as a lawyer. I was a lawyer back then in Canary Wharf. I'm going through Canary Wharf. And I'm like, how much more good immigrant do you have to be? And I was like, oh, it doesn't matter.
Yep.
All that matters is that we're different. It doesn't matter what money we earn, what we bring to the economy. The fact is, it's black and brown people or people with different accents, and you don't like that. That is enough of a threat to people.
So growing up in my parents are just late Windrush generation.
Mm.
And I grew up feeling like I was an immigrant, even though, you know, born here, Dulwich, Peckham, Elkent Road, all that sort of stuff, absorbing all the cultures, DJing. I still felt like an immigrant. Partly was parents rubbing off of what they've experienced, but also, you know, being in the underclass in the rough part of Peckham, etc. I also felt that I was an immigrant. And then you know, I traveled a bit and I felt like as I got older, I was absorbing a bit more into society and that lessened slightly. But when events like what happened at the Euros, I felt like I was an immigrant again. I just felt like I'd regressed in terms of my mental state and how I saw myself in this country.
And the racist abuse, you're referring obviously like the racist abuse that the players got when they missed penalties, their penalties saved. And the funny things as well, like these players were shooting against Donnarumma. Like Donnarumma saves like 30% of all his penalties, like for Italy and AC Milan. Like he's a great goalkeeper. But the racist abuse was so interesting because this is the first time actually, weirdly enough, that white people that I knew all knew what was coming. That was like about the race consciousness. They're aware of the level of racism in England now, I think. And I say specifically England, not Scotland. England specifically. Scotland has its issues, but England has its own particular. The one thing I would say about feeling like, more like an immigrant, I understand that, but at the same time, I would say people are asking you to vacate space. So now I'm like, I'm English. I'm not British, I'm English. Wow. People ask, certain contexts.
I see myself as British.
But then again, I was like, well, what is that about? Like, because we're not Scottish, we're not Welsh. So what, British is a catch-all. What British is basically a way for a lot of people to be like, oh, no, I'm a English is for white people. That's what it is, really.
It could be a separate debate, because I think that if you can define what Englishness is, how do you associate yourself with it?
Well, put it this way. Black people play for England and they call themselves British. That's really interesting.
But you have England, you don't have a United Kingdom football club, but in athletics you have a United Kingdom.
But what I'm saying is, you ask an England player, a white England player, he plays for England, Harry Kane, how do you describe yourself? I'm English.
But a
black player playing for England, how do you describe yourself? Oh, I'm British. You're like, oh, Well, who is that for?
So, based on that understanding of racism in this country, how did you weigh up the potential danger of the racism that exists in Berlin versus the opportunities that you sought and are now capitalizing on?
Great question. Cost-benefit analysis.
Right.
Cost-benefit analysis. So it was like, okay, benefits of living in Berlin. Openness, queerness, generally queer city. Like, you know, there are... In England, there's still gay bars. In Berlin, any number of bars can be queer in terms of like the vibe, the energy, the acceptance, just the spontaneity to it. That was incredible.
Yeah.
The openness, the queerness, the affordability, obviously, the art scene.
Yeah.
Just the beauty, the natural beauty of the city, all these things. So those are all the benefits. The openness of the people, the directness, you know, the way you get things done. Then those are the benefits. Then there's the cost. And that's the racism, the organized far right. So you learn to be streetwise. You learn to be smarter.
Yeah.
Berlin's a funny place. I was talking to a friend of mine, amazing musician who's now a writer, a novelist. Calaf used to run this Buraco Son Sistema. It's a brilliant Kuduro outfit for like 10 years. Brilliant band used to run that.
Yeah.
He said Berlin has the highest number, I think, of African PhD students and doctors in Europe. Yeah. Like of all cities in mainland Europe. I don't think in the UK, but like Berlin's the highest. Like Africans with PhDs end up in Berlin.
Wow.
Yeah, because it's like, it's the cost benefit analysis. You're tapping into that incredible like intellectual culture, artistic culture, just the vibes, the openness, the nightlife, all of it.
It's worked for you, man.
It's been amazing, man.
You're sort of like exponentially, you've just like grown.
Yeah, I feel it.
And developed, and you're still bringing it. When you come back to London, you've still got that London. You haven't lost anything about your Londonness,
still
if you
there.
Like.
Yeah,
it's still there. But you just bring an outside energy that I think London needs, or Londoners need, because we know that you're a Londoner, but you bring just another dimension.
Oh, thanks, man.
Which is brilliant.
It's been such a vibe living there. Like, I feel very privileged. Like, you know, to say you lived between, to say I've lived in London and Berlin, like two of the world's great cities, such different perspectives, but also like the confidence I have now. I will say this, I don't normally swear on podcasts, but I would say Berlin has basically, it was amazing because it removed the last few fucks I didn't think I still had.
Okay.
It just makes you unafraid of things. Like, you're seeing people in some parts of the city, the far right will be there. They'll wear their kind of clothing. It's very sophisticated.
Yeah.
They've got a whole like ecosystem, the far right. They've got their clothing brands. They've got their nightclubs, their music. They've got everything. They've got, you know, Nazis.
They're
proper Nazis, right? So you've seen those people in public. First time you see them, when they're kind of clothing brands, they don't come at you, but they're wearing like their sort of little labels. I won't advertise them. I'll name names. Dignify it with advertising. But the first time I saw them, I was like, oh my God, this is like, and now I'm just like, until you do something, it's fancy dress. Until you do something.
Transvestism.
Is it? Yeah, exactly. You got to do something. Yeah, don't start now. Won't be none. And then like, that energy that I have now, the confidence I give off is like, someone actually noticed it. They said, your energy has changed since arriving in Berlin. And I was like, how? And they were like, that. That's that thing there, that's new.
Incoming compliment here. I was speaking to Ian Wright on Monday, and he said, he asked me how long I've known you. I told you like 15, 20 years nearly soon.
Yeah.
Scary.
Yeah.
And he said, one thing about you is that he noticed from you that you help him understand racism, manage racism in terms of how it affects you, but also, you know, just quantify it. And explain it, and your reactions online and how you manage it helps. It me too, how to address answers when people treat you in a certain way, intellectually, spiritually, and in terms of the energy, and how you teach everybody how to manage racism is amazing. And I think Berlin must have done that for you, and
it did.
You're reflecting that back in how you manage your tweet comments and your literature, etc. So thank you for that.
That's a huge thank you so much. You know, it means a lot because I think that really means a lot because, and also people have helped me and taught me. A great man, Christoph Linnaire, he's a costume designer for movies. You meet this man, it's one of these people, you know, you meet some people, you're like, I know that's what you do for a living.
Vibes.
Yeah, because he dresses like a kind of character from Dune. Yeah. Beautiful man. Yeah,
love it. And he can carry it off, right?
Black Frenchman, he's been in, he's an amazing man, Black Frenchman, been in Berlin for 25 years. Mm. You know, he's seen all of it. And he said, if I may use the kind of, the profanity here, just because in context, I said, how do you handle racism? Because I was struggling with stuff. He said,
yeah.
Someone calls you a nigger, you call them a Nazi. Wow. He said, you have to return the racism with the same energy that arrived. And I was like, wow, because I used to like joke stuff away and this and that, haha. But I was like, no, he said, because it enters. Like, racism's like a splinter, right? You've got to get out the womb, out the wound as quickly as it comes in.
Right.
Don't let it sink beneath your skin and get septic. He said, you've got to get it out. It's like, you know, poison from a wound. And he said, you return it with the same energy. And you see this man. This man's like an elderly black man, yeah. Like 60s. Nobody has messed with that man.
Wow.
Nobody. He was walking past a playground once and someone made a racist joke. He went into the school. He went into the school to the teacher and he said, someone shouted this and he gave a description of the insult.
Wow.
And also explained the origin of the insult. The origin of the insult. And now, when he walks past the school, people wave, they're friendly, they're like, oh yeah, because that man just broke it all down.
Yep, yep.
And I thought, wow, this man turned into a teachable moment. And the reason I realized I changed my attitude towards racism was, I used to like make, racism made me feel small.
Yes.
But now, so for example, here's an example. I was at a bar a few years ago with a friend, and we came out of the bar. It was a very nice sort of kind of shishi, like queer bar, like, you know, in the east of Berlin, you know, very fancy. I was in my bag.
We're going on tour.
We are going on tour for sure. So we come out of this bar, and he said, Musa, look at this. And I was like, it's pepper spray. I was like, what's that for? He said, well, because it's a Nazi bar around the corner. So in case we bump into Nazis, I've got my pepper spray. And I said, what if they bump into us?
Nice.
And I said, fear is a transaction. I'm not saying we shouldn't be afraid, but until it's time to be afraid, let's not decide that we're afraid.
Bit of detail here. How do you identify a Nazi bar? Is it just known or is it?
It's known.
Right.
It's known.
Okay.
They know. Like, there's an amazing website. I won't reveal it because we need to keep it private.
Of course.
There's a website in Berlin where they will tell you, the anti-fascists will be like, look out for this spot. That person lives there. That guy's a local organizer. That person does that. And you can basically just map your whole safety knowing who these people are.
Wow.
So there's a bunch of people doing like Nazi graffiti in the south of Berlin.
Yep.
And they knew who those people were months before they got arrested. They were like, it's these four people. And they got arrested months later.
So quick question, just on practicalities.
Yeah.
Could you speak German before you got there?
I could.
You brainy, so, brainiac.
So do you know what I did years before when I was at school?
Which one?
When I was at Eton.
Yeah.
Boarding school, I made the decision. I was like, which language are you going to learn? So I thought, okay, French. I love French, and I said I'll learn German as well because German is the hardest of the five main European languages, like German, English. The ones that I don't speak. It's the hardest one of those languages. If I learn it now. Because it'd be harder to pick up when you're 40. If I learn it when I'm 60, when my brain is really supple,
yeah.
By the time I get to like 40, I can go there and not be a problem. So I learned, my German was sitting unused for 20 years. All of a sudden, I was like, hang on a minute. I learned German 20 years ago.
Yeah, but doesn't it, some people, it festers.
It was still in order. It was still working. Like, it was still like, yeah, it was still like in good condition.
So hold on, wait a minute. You also took extra subjects as well, didn't you? As if that wasn't enough.
Yeah, yeah. I did, yes. I did, so I did four subjects. Back then it was like three A-levels, but I did a fourth one because I wanted to keep my brain occupied, you know? So I was like, okay. I did, yeah, medieval history, French, German, and maths. It's a nice spread just to keep my brain like properly, like, you know, everything turned.
So you could just hit the ground running once you got to Germany.
Yeah, it was cool. And like, you know, my German's not fluent, but it's good. Like if I go to another city.
Yeah.
Actually, the first time I used it for a full evening was a date, actually. There's nothing like a date to like, listen.
Focus.
To focus the mind. Listen, when that's at stake, everything clicks. Everything, yeah.
Okay. Z-axis question for you.
Yep.
What language do you think in?
Oh, I think in English for sure. But sometimes when the German is good, I've never dreamed in, you know, my best ever language, I think, before language was French. At one point, I was like so locked in with my French. I was like, I sometimes felt more myself speaking French than I was when I spoke English.
Stop that.
Yeah, that was back. That was a long time ago, like 20 years ago.
Wow. Well, listen, on to the next track.
Yeah.
This is Venom by Little Simz.
That's the one. Yeah.
Life sucks and I never try suicide. Mind's fucked even more than I realise. Time's up, keep it moving when she arrives. If you ever heard what I heard in my mind, never try, you would cry, that's a lie, you would die. I don't wanna ever come down from a high. I am in the best seat, from time and the next breed. If you're coming, come at me directly. Don't need no one to defend me. Souls in a place even I can't get to. Don't fuck with the deadly. Moon waves and open seas, quick coasting overseas. Fuck those who don't believe. They will never wanna admit I'm the best here. From the mere fact that I've got ovaries. It's a woman's world, so to speak. Pussy, you sour. Never giving credit where it's due, cause you don't like pussy and power, Venom. My, if you ever heard what I heard in the night, what a fright, must have been a parasite in my past life. I don't want to ever come down from a high. My soul was sending to the sky, it's just you and I. Gone, but I'm feeling too alive, trying to get me out of spite. Someone's got to pay, you ain't talking big amounts. Some kind of
I love discovering music.
I mean, yeah, I mean, especially Simz is just astonishing.
I've slept on her, you know. I've got my own issues with hip-hop and where it's going in different directions. Yeah. Maybe probably being an old middle-aged git. I'll own that. But I really enjoyed that. I'll tell you why. Because she was just flowing over the strings without
the
beat.
Unreal. The technical level to do that. There's very few rappers in the world that can do that. I saw Kano performing Signs in Life at the Royal Albert Hall.
Yep.
It's still the greatest live performance ever seen. And he did it over an orchestra. He performed Signs in Life. I've got chills even remembering it. Over strings, and it's one of the greatest things. He's wearing all white, backed by an orchestra, and just flowing.
I love that.
Oh man,
I love that.
The thing about Simz, the thing about her is, again, there's another artist that makes me feel brave.
Yeah,
so fearless, you know. And I was listening to her like quite early in my time in Berlin, and then I saw her. It was quite funny. I saw Simz. So I met her once when a guy that used to manage her. Shout out to Eddie.
Yeah.
On her first sort of Berlin appearance or tour, she was there. I met her actually backstage, had a quick chat with her. We're not in touch, we're not friends, but I just had a nice chat. She said, I love your work. And it was funny because then a few years later, I see Simz in Treptow Park, like, you know, not far from my place.
Yeah.
On a bike. She's just chilling.
Hang on, does she live there?
No, she was just there on holiday. And I said to mate, I saw Simz. I went on my Twitter. I was like, because normally, someone sees someone famous, people tweet about it.
Yeah.
But Berlin people are very low-key, so no one's done that. It's like, oh, I love it. Everyone's keeping her secret. That's good. Two months later, I hear her album, and she's like, oh, you might see me hanging low-key. Yeah. I might be hanging low-key in Berlin. And I'm like, that was it.
Okay,
I knew you were there.
Yeah.
I knew you were there.
That's good. So what is it about Venom that you liked in this track?
What I love about it is
why is it a 45, the technical, 45?
The technical audacity, just a sort of, I don't know if mastery is the right word, just the flawless, the exceptional level of the craft. Like, there's all these rappers have one track where they're just showing off their skill. Like Kendrick had it with like Rigor Mortis. Yeah. That's her Rigor Mortis. It's her calling card. It's like, this is pure skill. And she's got, it's like watching Ronaldinho do kick-ups.
Amazing. So wasn't gonna ask you, with that track and Little Simz, what do you feel? Cause you got skills. People don't know, but you flow. You used to be a rapper.
Yeah, it's true.
Or still are.
Yeah, I do.
Poet and stuff like that. Do you still want to do that? Or have you moved on to poetry now? What's your relationship?
You know, it's funny with music. Like, we had some... Music was responsible for so many of my greatest joys, but also heartbreaks.
Yeah.
So I went to Berlin. Short answer is I don't do that much of it anymore.
Yeah.
I'm going to release one last album, I reckon, with my project BBXO, and that'll be it. That'll be my last record. And the album's going to be called Keep Loving, Keep Pushing. Like, so when I moved to Berlin, it was funny because I was done with music. I was like, okay, I'm finished with this now. And I basically moved, I recorded one last EP and then left. Released it. And then it got picked up on all these like streaming sites. Like someone basically like wrote, one of the biggest radio stations in Italy, Radio Rai 2, they wrote like an essay about it. They were like, this song, and it went to like number one in like independent like streaming charts.
Lovely.
And I was like, what? So then I, someone in Berlin heard it and signed me to a publisher. I got a publishing deal. Like they just off the basis of one song.
I love that when it happens.
Same publishers like Max Richter, Ludovic Einaudi, like all this like Johan Johansson and this publisher. And they basically signed me. And then I went and did a gig in 2018 at Reeperbahn Festival. And the same, was a record label called Clouds Hill. They put out Mars Volta. They basically like heard it and they were like, wow. And they signed me basically like listening to me then. Like it was all kind of going well. And then they were like, there were always creative differences. Like, want this to change on that. And I just thought, you know what? I'm like, I'm 39. I'm not 22 anymore. I can't keep doing this. I can't keep start again, revamp. And that's actually weird enough. It's a good thing that I didn't push too hard on the music because the pandemic came along. Imagine if I'd been full in music and then pandemic had come. Whereas because I was like, I'm not feeding music too much anymore. It's so many years I've been doing it. I just reconfigured and started podcasting. And the podcasting took off, like so, complete chance.
So did you have, because you've been an early, what I call entrepreneur, what I mean is poet, writer, you've had just plenty of game. A lot of people are doing that now as fallbacks or added career aspirational. You just happened to just flourish like that and just do, you did it fairly early. Where did that confidence come from?
You know, it's weird. So people call it confidence. It's so strange because, how do I say this? I had not seen myself as confident. I used to joke, I was like, I'm the shy poet. I used to joke and everyone was like, no, you're not. But I was like, I was only half joking because I didn't see myself as confident.
But based on the pressures that, not the pressures, but the education you had, what you can be, what your parents want you to be, what as a black person sometimes you carry, if you're doing well, you must do very well because
representation.
Right.
Do you know what? So far, you're completely right. I was actually out the other day. I was actually out last night with a bunch of friends of mine. They all made like millions. They're making millions a year, these guys. And we were at the same law school together. And they went on and became millionaires. And I went and did this. And like, I think the pressure is, there is a lot of pressure in a way, isn't there? To kind of, to conform or at least go and make some money because they're, at least go and make like, you know, six figures because they're making a million. But I was like, you know what? I have got a very clear path. There's a very clear sense of what I want to say. Like, you know, there's things to say about the world. Like, don't get me wrong. Like, I love my friends. I love them. But if I'm in a building for the last 20 years accumulating lots of money, I don't have a voice in the world. Because I can't speak. You think about it, there's 20 years you haven't spoken. Now, it's all very well to come out now and start doing your thing. But who's going to listen to me? They're like, you spent 20 years in that building. And now you've enriched yourself. You want to start saying things. It's like, no, where were you the last 20 years?
Wow.
Whereas like, I never went away. I never went away. Yeah, I was in a different country, but I never stopped speaking about the things. And I know it's not to big myself up. What I will say is, younger black people, the nicest thing is, they're like, this guy didn't sell us out.
Yeah.
This man had this privilege and didn't sell us out. And that's the biggest compliment in many ways, because they're like, this guy had all of this stuff and didn't start going, oh, black people, raise yourselves up. You're not motivated. I never did that because I don't believe that.
For me, what I like, and I think other people will say the same, is you use your education, we're all educated, but the type of education you've got at Eton, you use it so effectively in the way you debate, you discourse and carry out discourse. It's like you speak in a style that some of us can't articulate, and you manage to convey our emotion while still speaking the language of...
That means a lot. That means a lot, because it's difficult. Because you know what it is? And I have a lot of sympathy for people, because you're expected to experience pain and then express it in an eloquent way, which is kind of perverse. It's like hammering a nail through your foot, then expecting to give like, oh, this is why my foot hurts. It's like, no, I should be screaming.
But when you do that, what it does is it gives us a certain calm that we can't always get when we're put in those situations. So you do that for us. So I think that sometimes you argue on our behalf and you bring that calm and you give us that, yes, that's what I wanted to say at that point.
That feels really good.
You do it globally. So it sort of gives us this sort of, not comfort, but you know, you speak on behalf of us in a very, very good way.
Oh, thanks, man. That means a lot, because you know what it is? That means a lot, because sometimes I do these radio shows and I do TV and I'm like, did I do people justice? It's the pressure. It's like being black, right?
Yeah, of course.
It's pressure. Like, you know, at the end of the day, I went to see my sister. My sister lives in Dubai. I went to see her. and there were not many black people on the plane. There were like three
yeah.
out of like hundreds. And I said to my sister, I said, listen, if you get the academic qualifications of those black men on that plane and the black women, guaranteed our qualifications will be top 1% in the world. And the average person going to Dubai, white person, just the regular white person.
Yep.
For us even to be on that plane,
yes.
the barriers we have to overcome.
I didn't even think about that. Yeah.
The barriers. I went to Brazil to this hotel, right, when I was in the World Cup thing. When I walked in, the black people in the lobby almost clapped. The way they looked at me, so much pride, they're like, one of us is a guest here. One of us is a guest here. That's the level of it.
But those that situation just expressed there, that's really important. Yeah. It's sad, but it's also really important. You know, you elevate people in different ways just by your existence.
Because we're on our way. Yeah, they see you. They're like, we're on our way because they see you there minding your business. I was there for 9 days.
Yeah,
and I only saw one other black person who was a guest in that
wow.
hotel.
Wow.
Yeah.
So onto hip hop. Hip hop for a second.
Yeah.
Tell me about your love affair with hip hop. How you fell in love with it, and secondly, because we'll digress. Hopefully you bring you back. What is it like listening to hip hop at Eton? Because how did you represent that? Because I know it must have been big when you were there as well. So
it was amazing. Okay. Oh my God. Yeah. No, it was amazing. Okay, let's go. Okay, so I fell in love with hip hop, I would say, twice. The first time was Arrested Development when I heard the 3-5-2 album.
Yeah.
Amazing record, crossover record.
Yeah.
Maybe slightly before then, I was into like Young MC and that stuff. But the real love began with Young MC, Positive K, I Got a Man.
Yeah. That.
The real love. Dun, 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 dun. I Got a Man. Not trying to
I
head
told
up. Yeah, probably Young MC and Positive K was the first time, and then Arrested Development.
You know, Young MC's English.
Really?
Born
funny.
England. Go on.
Like Slick Rick.
Exactly.
I Wickham. Energy, listen. Oh. Back to the seeds. There
back. Go on.
Yeah, it's a dial it back. So the second time I fell in love hard with hip hop was my granddad died in 1996, and loads of cousins came over for the funeral from all over, like Uganda. Some came from the US, whatever. My US cousins came over. And we drove down to London one night in a kind of like convoy, like, you know, all the cousins drove down like at midnight just for fun. And they were playing this song in the car. And I turned to a friend and I was like, what is this? It was chilling. It was brilliant. It was mind blowing. It was Shadow Boxing by GZA.
All right.
And I was like, what is this? Who are these people? And I was just like, my mind was blown. It's like, oh, that's Wu-Tang. That's GZA.
Yeah.
And I went and like Wu-Tang basically was like my obsession. So in terms of how it was listening to hip hop at Eton, it was amazing because you had like the international scholars. And you had the basketball team. And the basketball team, which I was on, I suppose I was a shooting guard.
Yeah.
No, not bad. I had the crossover, had the fadeaway, had the
continue, please.
Listen, it is what it is. It is what it is. We're not gonna get into it, but listen. So the moment we got on the team coach, the team bus, Wu-Tang came on.
Wow.
We had the playlist. We were like the coach driver was always so cool. He was like, yeah, play what you like. So we just played Wu-Tang straight through. That's like a 2.5 hour journey there and back.
Yeah.
So the hip-hop heads would like kind of congregate around basketball.
Yeah. That's amazing because my relationship with hip-hop is earlier, say 10 years earlier with the breaking and all that sort of stuff. The West Indian community or the black community, either you're into reggae or you're into soul. I asked Wrighty about this. There was like a divide between a sweet boy and a reggae man. We could do both. You know, you could traverse both. You'd have like revival dancers. But me growing up, I grew up on that music and I love my reggae, I love my soul, but I wanted something else. I was just thriving with something else. I love my soul, my funk, and I inherited my dad's record collection. And I loved all that, but there was something about having an audio collage, just mixing bits and bobs off of which I felt I was as a English or British person living there. I was absorbing all different cultures. Hip hop was just brought all that in for me.
Yeah.
You know, I could listen to punk, I could listen to rock, all the samples they were using. And that actually formed not my personality, but how I saw myself in the world. You know, some of my resultant parts were all of these things. So that's my relationship with hip hop. And I just fell in love with all that and the various parts of expression.
Yeah.
The art, the poetry.
And the elements of hip hop, the elements that they, a friend of mine ran a graffiti magazine.
Wow.
Yeah. He was like one of the big graph artists. He had like a tag, like he was one of the big graph artists in the UK and as an Etonian as well. And you'd see his tag like in all these places. Yeah.
So hip hop went down in Eton.
You had your hip, because you know it's a big school, it's 1,250 people.
Okay.
So within that, you can find your own ecosystem. So we had like the skaters. The skaters all loved hip hop. They loved basketball. Like George Carver. Shout out to George Carver. Amazing crossover.
Yeah.
Could shoot the three from anywhere. Like super cool guys. Like, and the basketball team was like, it was a cool thing.
No, I would not. I apologize for my ignorance here. I just thought it was just hardcore, upper middle class sensibilities that I thought cascaded down culturally.
It didn't, because a lot of those people now are extremely socially conservative, actually, weirdly enough, because the gravitational pull of their surroundings, ultimately, hip-hop can't withstand that, right? Especially as you get older, start getting more money, you buy back into those worlds that you're in. But for a moment in your teens, you're exposed to this other universe.
Yep.
And that was when the Fugees album landed in 96. And I heard Fuji La, and I went next door to my mate Jonathan, and I said, the Fugees are coming. I remember being like, the Fugees are coming. I heard them on Westwood late one night, This song, this group's going to take over the world. It was Fuji La.
So speaking of hip-hop samples, this is your next Fortified. The song's called Harlem Rhythm Jive by Bobbi Humphrey. I fell in love with this song back in 86 when Jazzy Jeff sampled it in a song called A Touch of Jazz. Great choice. I just want to hear a bit of that.
Yeah.
Listen.
Oh my God.
I can listen to that.
There are three songs that will always be New York to me. This one, Nas, The World Is Yours.
Yeah.
And Mad Villain, Raid. The opening verse of Raid by MF Doom.
Wow.
Those three things will always, the moment, every time I hear those songs, that when I hear Harlem River Drive, it takes me to New York. When I hear this song, it's like, it's autumn in New York. And it's 8 p.m. and it's dark and Manhattan, the lights are twinkling. You know, because when you arrive in New York, when you land in New York and you drive in the taxi, however you get in, you enter the city halfway. You enter Manhattan halfway up.
Yep.
You're right. You're immediately
Lexington,
in the guts.
Lexington.
Yeah, you're not, it's not like in when you come to London with like M4 through Chiswick and you ease yourself in. You come into the heart of Manhattan Island.
Yep.
You know, right into the heart. And Harlem River Drive is actually named after the actual road.
Yep.
If you've literally been to New York for a split second, and there's something about that, it gives you something you'll never forget. Like even when you leave New York, when you get the taxi away to fly out of JFK, it's a really heartbreaking departure because you come out of the city and then you curve round, and the skyline is on your left for like an hour. As you're going towards JFK, the skyline's on your left for an hour before it disappears. And it's almost like it's saying, really? You're going to leave this? You know when you've been with your partner, with a lover, and you got to go to work early, and they're lying there going, really? You're going to leave this? New York's like that. It's just lying there going.
I like that.
Yeah.
For you, it's autumn. For me, it's spring, and they're changing seasons.
Of course. The transition.
The transition.
Oh my God, we do a whole podcast on transition.
Exactly. And for me, you know, I lived in New York on and off for 5 years. I've got a different relationship. For me, it reminds me of the FDR, which is on the east side. And it takes you right the way down. You can get to Brooklyn from there, where I lived. Very, very similar. Twinkling lights.
Yeah.
But it calms me, this song. For New York, which is a very exciting city, it's quite calming for me as well. It just centers me as well. So I think that's just a great choice.
This person's going for a drive. You think about the kind of the psychology of it. Shout out to Bobbi Humphrey, amazing artist.
Yeah. Yep.
In her late 70s now. Bobbi Humphrey, amazing. If you think about the psychology of it, stressed out in a city like Manhattan and going for a drive in the evening. And there's a lyric, baseball lights shining in the night. Oh my God.
Bronx. That's the Bronx.
Oh my God.
It's the Yankee Stadium.
Yeah, the Yankee Stadium.
It's the Yankee Stadium right there.
Yankee Stadium. Exactly. That's the one. Everyone knows. When you say that, everyone knows the road. Everyone knows. Yeah, everyone's seen it. Everyone's seen that. The baseball lights shining in the night. Everyone's seen it.
Really, really nice.
Amazing tune.
So talk to me about the places you've travelled to and the relationships, because you seem to be just, which you, similar to me, you can just adapt most countries. Which country didn't you like? Where? What? I know it could be due to work, but what countries didn't you like and for what reason?
You know, it's funny, it's the countries that change. So I went to Bratislava in Slovakia. The first time I went there, didn't like it. Well, I had a good time then until I got attacked by, I was walking home. If they know when we've been, I was walking home with a friend of mine, Dave, and I get slapped in the face, or not slapped, I get smacked in the face, punched in the face by skinhead, leather jacket.
Sorry, man.
Yeah, there were two guys coming towards us and I was like, I can probably take one or two of them, but my mate is the least, he's the skinniest of us all. If we start a fight, we're going to lose because it's a mismatch, right? So I went back to mine, went back to his place, and then like we left the next day, flat the next day. Yeah. And we got to the door and he was like, you okay, Moose? I was like, well, I burst out laughing. And he was like, why? Why are you laughing? I said, well, that's a skinhead, right? How many black men has he met in Slovakia? I mean, I've probably made his day, but tomorrow I leave. And then after I'm gone, there'll be no more black men in Slovakia to beat up. So joke's on him, really. That joke's on him.
Wow, the way you approach that.
Well, years later, we were going to have a stag do there. My friend had a stag do. So, oh, we're going to Bratislava. And I was like, I'm not sure about that. It's a bit racist. Went there years later, and it was amazing. These black guys came up to me in a bar, and they came up to us at a restaurant. They didn't approach anyone else. Came up to me and said, like, oh, brother.
They were like,
come to this bar. And I was like, why? And they said, well, women approach men here. They approach black men here. Because they said, if you're a black man in Slovakia, you're there because you've got a professional job. You're like an engineer, you're a doctor, or a footballer. They both play for Slovan, the top team.
Nice.
So if you're here, basically, you're just like a professional. I'm like, oh. I was like, this is like being white. This is what it's like for white guys. Like, I was like, oh my God, and being in Bratislava.
You just blow my mind with that.
Being in Bratislava is responsible for my worst and my best experience while traveling.
Wow.
How wild. And it's funny, like, travel is... Places can be in transition even as you are in transition.
Yes.
So, yeah.
And you have to allow for that as well.
Yeah. Wild. I mean, I've been to so many places. I've been working in Shanghai and 2017 I was working in Shanghai and
what was
Beijing.
That like?
I've got to say, I mean, first thing, Shanghai, like the pollution. Oh my God. Gorgeous city, but wow, like the pollution. Beijing was fascinating because, you know, Beijing's very wealthy. Like, in a way, people don't realize that Beijing's wealthier than Shanghai. That's the biggest Mercedes dealership in the world, I think. Very interesting. I wanted to go to these places and see them from the inside, like these countries, authoritarian states. Yeah. As a writer, I like to sort of see inside and have conversations. Funny thing with China was, if you just want to make money, right? Just want to like have an affluent life.
Yeah.
Incredible, incredible, incredible country to live in. But when it comes to critiquing anything political, my friends would whisper. They would whisper. Like one friend of mine, I went to see him. He would only talk about the political situation like at 2 a.m. when whispering, when drunk, in his own flat. Like people don't criticize politics there.
That inherent fear.
Like self-censorship is just huge there. It's huge, yeah.
Wow.
All over, obviously Brazil for the World Cup.
Yeah.
The US. I mean, just the other day I was listing all the cities I'd worked in. It was just like, my goodness,
Good for you, man.
I've really lived, really fortunate. I've been lived.
So busy. Globetrotting. How does Musa Okwonga chill out? How do you switch off?
I don't really.
I know, and you should. As older brother talking to you now.
You know what it is? I appreciate it. You know what it is? One thing I will say, I say I don't chill. That's a bit facetious. I had a month off this summer, the first time ever. At the end of the Euros, I basically took a month off, didn't go on Twitter.
Nice.
Was on Instagram now and again for fun, just on the gram. You know the gram. And I at least once a week, I just treat myself to like a nice meal, like a €20 dinner somewhere. Yeah, nothing fancy, but €20, a glass of red wine, you know, some pasta or something, and just sat out like on the promenade because Berlin's got this great street culture. Just sit there. And just really reading. I love books, man. I love sinking into a novel. Just read Dune recently in no time at all. Just bashed out in 3 days. Like, I love reading, music, just listening to music, and just wandering.
Good.
Walking, long walks. Sometimes they got on the train. Actually, it was funny. I bumped into a friend. I was in Berlin recently, and I was on the train. And a friend was like, oh, what are you doing here? What are you doing all the way out here? Like way out west? And I said, well, often what I do is I get on a train with a novel, I put my headphones on, and then just ride the train and listen to, like, read a book.
Nice.
And he was like, oh, that sounds really peaceful. I was like, yeah, it's gorgeous. Yeah.
So you obviously were quite productive over, am I right in saying that you're quite productive over the pandemic? Because sounds like you just, I mean, I got the idea for Fortified 45s, big up to Charlie Dark, do my radio shows. Run Them Radio, big up to those guys there. And I became really inspired. And I think it's really important, some people who, to have a hobby or a passion, because, you know, I think it came to the fore, people who don't have hobbies.
Yes.
You know, can suffer in those
situations. I was lucky because I had the podcast Stadia that I do with Ryan. We do that twice a week. So I was having regular contact, regular conversations. And also I was reading a lot, but also I was writing a lot. Like I wrote a children's book, actually, the book over the Ian starting out.
Yeah. How did you find it? Where did you get your juice from in the middle of a pandemic?
Do you know what's funny? I treated writing my book like, you know, when like, you know, on a long distance plane ride, you watch like three movies.
Yeah.
I treated writing my book with Ian like I was just on a long plane journey. So I got like a nice beanbag chair, like it's like a beanbag armchair, it's like an armchair full of like, you know, sort of polystyrene balls. Put my feet up on like, put my most comfortable tracksuit, put my feet up on my bed and just had my laptop in my lap. And I was like, I might as well be on a long distance plane journey. Like just, I was in my little world typing away for like a few hours every day.
Yeah.
And then when I came out of that space, I was like, pick a really good immersive movie or a really good book.
Yep.
And that was how I navigated the pandemic. I was like, just treat the world, almost reconfigure the world. So, okay, this is it. You know, pandemic is effectively like doing like, it's like being like long distance space travel.
You can't
go outside, right? So how do you make your immediate environment?
I love that analogy.
How do you make your immediate environment as comfortable as possible, as nurturing as possible? So I just went to IKEA and just picked up a load of stuff and made my space really like
nice,
comfortable and gentle and warm. And that was the key.
So you sort of worked with the pandemic.
Yeah, you work with it. Exactly.
So how did you work collaboratively with Ian to, you know, structure the book, obviously the idea.
Yeah.
How did you do that within a pandemic, remotely, you know, you're not in the same space, but still make
it's
it
weird.
Work?
It's weird how you think. I never thought of it that way before, but...
Sorry, yeah.
No, but it's funny and it's fascinating. It's a great question because it was a difficult pressure, different pressure, and the time pressure was quite tight as well because it wasn't like they weren't like, oh, we're in a pandemic,
chill,
extend the deadline. No, they were... But I delivered it a day early. Listen, it is what it is.
Stop it now.
Listen, it is what it is.
Seriously.
We get it. Yeah, always. You always get a deadline. You want to deliver on time. So
yeah.
With the, we're striking out. We wanted to do a book, which wasn't just Ian's life story, because a lot of people knew that by then. We wanted to do a book where you had like Ian, not just the football, but Ian the man, Ian the uncle, the grandfather, the dad, the mentor. What's that Ian like? Because a lot of people don't know that side of him.
Yeah.
Right? They see it, they get a sense, they don't know it. So the idea was to get a version of it, to get Ian basically mentoring a younger boy who was basically like, you know, what would it be like for Ian Wright to grow up now? How would he look now?
Wow.
So like a guy with the swag of Ian Wright. So Ian sees him playing on Hackney Marshes. This is the story, the fiction that we made up. Ian sees this guy playing and was like, this guy's got a vibe. Why is he playing at this level? He's on a high, he's like me. Why is he not playing at a high level? So Ian helps him. Ian mentors him. So the way we did it was we just talked out the entire plot. We were like, okay, this is the journey we want him to go on. He basically like rises to grace, falls from grace, then rises again, like a proper hero's journey.
Of course.
And he's got his own issues, his own challenges. Obviously, you know, Ian was in Broccoli, you were in Peckham.
Yep.
This guy
down
was he's hacking around the corner. This guy was from the estate where he's from is the one behind Mare Street.
Nice.
So he's based on that. It's very much based on Hackney life.
So speaking of life stories, if you had to take a certain period of your life and we made it into a movie, which period in your life would it be and who would be the actor?
Oh my God. Do you know what it might be? Weirdly, it might be my 20s.
Okay.
Do you know why? Because I'm still too scared to write about my 20s. Do you know when I came out, actually, weirdly enough, Stonewall was one of the things that kept me sane, because life was so hard in my 20s. I was like, oh, at least next year can't be worse than this.
Yeah.
And each year got worse.
Yeah.
Each year got worse. From the age of 22, so I broke up with my then girlfriend, who was amazing.
Yep.
That was horrific. I was like, okay, 2003 was really bad, but 04 can't be worse. 04 was worse. 04 was really bad. 05 can't be worse. 05 was worse. For 3 years straight in my 20s, everything got worse.
20s are tough, man.
And also, this is like, I'm a black man, went to Eton, right? And I thought I'd navigated challenges being gay or bisexual as a black man in London in your early 20s. Back then, holy, oh my God. Like, that's the period I would write a film about. And to be honest, I think that I've not written about that yet, because I think I haven't, I've processed it. But I think there's parts of it that are too painful to look at.
Watch this space then.
honestly, but that would be the one. But in terms of who would play it, I mean, goodness, I mean, probably an unknown actor.
Okay.
I think an unknown actor, because that's the key. I think the key would be to have adults who are well-known.
Yep.
Adults who are well-known, but an actor who's completely unknown as a kind of like, as not a breakout role, but a role to really, because sometimes if you've got an actor that's well-known for a story like that, it kind of, it detracts.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
But my God, yeah, that was the 20s. Jeez. How did I make it? I don't know how I made it, to be honest.
Good. Next track?
Yep.
Next track we've got is We Do by Lxury. Now, I've never heard of these guys.
Oh my God. So I think it's one producer. And I don't even know how I stumbled across it. You know, like the old days, iTunes, you used to go through iTunes and basically listen to 30-second snippets.
Yep.
And find something you liked. I really got into Lxury when I was moving to Berlin. That tune came out in 2013, I think it was.
Yep.
I moved to Berlin a year later and I needed a song that would help me feel brave and open to the city. And this song's got a vibe where it just makes you, I don't know, it just makes your heart open up.
Let's check it out.
Let's do it.
We do.
Too many musical journeys. I'm loving your choices, by the way.
Oh, thanks, man.
That for me is, oh my gosh, 90s house, a bit of disclosure, but exactly. I can hear the Berlin in there.
Yes, very, you know, much.
The sharp, crisp hi-hats, yes. the sparseness of it as well.
I needed a song that sounded like the city I was moving to or in,
uh-huh,
that would give me the kind of energy. So it was almost like, it was funny, it was like soundtracking the city.
Yeah.
But also soundtracking my successful journey through the city, if that makes sense.
Yeah. And was that a big song in Berlin, or was it just something that described it to you?
Described it to me. Yeah, and I think it's one of those funny ones, because I was sometimes like, I think now and again I would tweet stuff, and the producer would like my tweets, because I was like so enthusiastic. He'd be like, "Wow, who is this like random dude just like getting completely gassed over my music?" It was a perfect soundtrack for my early months there.
Brilliant. And where's Musa now? You know, what's happening? How you feeling about life, or, you know, the world going forward? You know,
I'm content.
Wow.
Like, if I never, I said to my friend the other day, it's so strange. If I never wrote another word, I'd feel like I'd made my defining work. Wow. I didn't mean that in a complacent way. I meant like, you know, as an artist, like, have I made the work that I came here to make?
Yep.
And like, I'm making that work. And I'm not trying to sound cocky by saying that. What I mean is, like, I'm 42 now, right?
Yeah.
We're all old enough that we've lost friends, relatives, illnesses, you know, whatever, like cancer, car crashes. We've lost people, right? We know, like, and not to sound somber or morbid, but just 2 months ago, I lost a good friend, Richard Diffenthal. He died. He was 40 years old. His heart stopped. He had 3 kids, and I was at law school with him. So I knew this guy from uni, actually. I knew this guy from the age of 20. Known him for 20 years, and his heart stopped one day. Now, the reason I talk about being content is I'm trying to look at life where one day it could be your time, and you want to be able to like say, I made my work in my time. You know, Richard only got 40 years. I've been given 42. My dad only got 40. You know, people I know, like my friend Ian got 48. Graham Joy's got 49, Ollie Broom got 21, Tom Fenwick got 23. I think of my friends all the time, like my dead friends, dead family, whatever. And I'm like, how do I feel? I feel content because I was given more time than a lot of them. And I think I made good use of my time. So I literally walk around feeling like, I walk around with a buzz. I walk around with a kind of like a sense of, I've made the work I'm here to do. And I'm just going to keep making it till my time is done.
That is so inspirational. You've just gassed me up just thinking about it and reevaluating my next steps and how I'm
going to
move forward.
Yeah. That's how I look at it.
Yeah.
I look at it. If you ever think of what project to do next, I'm like, if you could only make one more project, what would it be? And that's how I look at it. If you could only write one more book, what would the book be? What would the song be if you could make one more song? And that is my filter. It's a very good filter, actually. It's a very good filter.
Now I know where you get your juice from. That's part of the secret. Well, listen, let's get into your final song, a song called Donna by Rubblebucket. Let's check this out. Surprise.
If I ever have a sound clash with anybody, I'll just drop that at some point.
That's in my crates. That's in my crates.
If that's
in my crates.
You draw for that one. You know, I mean,
I'm drawing for that.
You draw for it because, you know, if you drop that, people will be like, what? It's amazing. It's a piece of music. It's unreal, isn't it?
It took a little turn there. I was like, what's going on there? What does that bring to me? It brings a bit of Fleetwood Mac in there.
Bingo. Yes. Yes. You know, also, it's Fleetwood Mac. Want to be with the everywhere type vibes.
All right.
Yeah, and also, you know, think about this song as well. This song for me is very spiritual in two ways. It's a song about transition. I feel transition. So when I hear this song and I think of, you know, when you fly, you're flying from a European capital at like 3 p.m. You're taking like a mid-afternoon flight, which
like
is the ultimate freedom because it means you've got so much control over your time. You can get a 3 p.m. flight. So you can go public transport when things are quiet. So someone traveling that time is in command of their schedule.
I like that.
Right? And it's like, it's a sunny day and you look at the airport. You know, there's ones who like, you look at the airport terminal and the planes, the fleet of planes are all gleaming there. That whole energy is like, but also quite spiritual because it feels like there's something about the song which is like, it's joyful, but there's also like a melancholy.
Yeah, yeah.
It's like a bittersweet.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It's like a nostalgia. So it's like, it's the kind of song you listen to when you're like remembering like a lover or a long past. Yeah. But
Wow.
So that song does a lot, but that song actually, if I had to describe, you ask me where I am now, that song is literally where I am now.
I love that.
Reflecting on all the beautiful things, but still moving forward. That's that song.
For me, it's like a plane banking.
Yes, yes, yes. I love that.
It's just banking, but it's got some colourful lines in it, so it's quite reflective. You can hear, you know, the reflection of the sounds in there.
You ever caught the sunrise on a plane? You ever caught the sunrise on a plane?
Of course.
Most people are asleep by then, right? So it's like 2% of the plane is actually awake, right? It's you, the pilots, and a couple other people, but everyone else is basically out.
Yeah.
You open the window and you just see that pink gleaming.
Yeah.
The amount of times I've captured that. What I learned to do, the way to take perfect photos, I realized, was actually not to take a photo, but take the video and then screenshot the cat. And then I would, and this song feels to me like a sunrise. Yeah, yeah.
Amazing, amazing. Yeah, yeah. Musa, thank you for 4545. Thank you for being my maiden voyage, my journey.
Thank you
for being aspirational. Keep doing what you're doing. We're loving doing what you're doing. Don't leave it so long next time, please.
I promise I won't.
Thank you for joining me.
My pleasure, man.
Cheers.
Five, 45, 45, 45, 45.